In this video, I'll talk about the basics of the intermolecular forces and then use some of those basic ideas to determine which substance in each of these pairs has the higher boiling point. Intermolecular forces are those forces that hold one molecule to another molecule, not the forces that hold just one molecule together. For example, if we have an H2O molecule, we're not talking about the bonding forces between hydrogen and oxygen atoms. Rather, we are talking about the intermolecular forces, that is, what holds one water molecule next to another water molecule so that we have liquid or solid water. So in red here, I've got the intermolecular forces, this imaginary force field here, invisible force field. What is holding water together? Well, let's examine the water molecule. If I were to draw a Lewis structure, it would be like this, and I would have the hydrogen atoms bonded below, and this is a bent molecule. That's its molecular geometry, and therefore we have some dipole moment. And because we have a dipole moment, we have something more negative. So I'm going to draw an outline here, and I'm going to say it's more negative up here than it is down here. So that's one water molecule. Then if I have another water molecule, say negative here and positive here and here, notice that this dipole moment of these water molecules, the dipole moment of these water molecules attracts the negative to the positive. So this is called dipole-dipole. Dipole-dipole. So one molecule is attracting another simply because they are both have dipole moments, or they are both polar. Now, what about neon and xenon? Well, these are just atoms, so they absolutely are not polar. They do not have polar moments. But think about these atoms as a large water balloon, or just as water balloons. And you know, when you have a water balloon, this water balloon has, or this atom has, some electrons. This is the electron cloud. So I'm making the analogy of the electron cloud as a water balloon. Now, these electrons within an atom are moving all over the place, moving, moving, moving. So at any given time, this could happen, just like when you squeeze a water balloon. At any given time, you could have a concentration of electrons that is more to one side of the atom. And so therefore, this would be instantaneously polar. This atom would be instantaneously polar. And that happens all the time for just short moments of time, but it happens all the time with all of these, it can happen for all of these different neon or xenon atoms or any atom. And so what you have, and it's changing all the time from one atom to the next, but what you have is something called a dispersion forces. And that is because like I said, you have a higher concentration of electrons on one side of the atom more than the other side of the atom. So then you have, it's like it's polar. And so one atom attracts to the other. And they can happen for molecules as well. A molecule, even if the molecule is not polar. So dispersion forces is what would attract the atoms or the molecules, even if they are not polar. So in all three of our examples here, we do not have polar molecules or atoms. So the dispersion forces are greatest if you have more electrons. So just like with the water balloon analogy, if you have a very large water balloon filled with more water, or in our case, the electron cloud is larger, it's intuitive to us that it's kind of easier to misshape that water balloon, and it's easier to misshape that electron cloud. So we have it like this, and again, it's not like this all the time, it's just changing, it's continuously changing the position of the electrons. And so you might have another one like this, and you have the more negative side, the more that is more electronegative, attracting the part of the other atom or molecule that is less electronegative. So this has some mysterious, invisible intermolecular force. So what am I getting at with all this? It's this. The atom or the molecule that has more electrons in the atom or the molecule will have greater dispersion forces. So that is if given that these are not polar, right? If they have dipole moments, if they're polar, then we have to account for that, for their attraction. But as I already said, none of these six substances which I've written here have dipole moments. So we're just going to look at the number of electrons. So let's go right down the line. Xenon has more electrons than neon, so this has a higher boiling point. That is, this has greater dispersion forces, and therefore it takes more energy, a higher temperature, to boil the xenon, to get it away from the solid, away from liquid, into just the gaseous form, xenon. Okay, CO2 or CS2. Neither of these is polar. So for example, we've got O is on the outside, O, and then C, and then double bond to O, and also with S, double bond to C, double bond to S, and we also have our paired electrons on the outside, on the S, and on the O. So these are not polar, but we can just look at which has more electrons. It's the CS2 has more electrons, so it experiences more dispersion forces. And then let's just save some time. CH4, that's tetrahedral, so that is not polar, and the Cl2 is just linear. Of course, it's diatomic with the same atom, so that is not polar. And so therefore, we just go to counting electrons, it is Cl2. Again, in most cases, I will say, if the atom or the molecule has more electrons and the atom or molecule is not polar, then it's simply the atom or molecule that has the greatest number of electrons will then give us the greatest dispersion forces, and then it will have the greatest or the highest boiling point. I hope that was helpful. If you did find that helpful, consider liking it or sharing it with a friend.